that's, I mean, that's the, that's my computer. And I just turned it off.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to our Christmas service. Please come on in if you haven't already and grab a seat. Our welcomers can help you if you need a hand. Well, it's Christmas Day again. It comes around quick, doesn't it? Unless you're one of those people who are counting down since something like October. Where were you this time last year? Maybe it's a bit of a stretch for your memory. Maybe you were right here. Maybe not. I wonder how your year was. Every one of us has experienced this year differently. We've all got different emotions connected to 2023. Different memories stand out for each of us. Christmas seems to be a good time to stop and reflect. There is something so precious, though, about being here today, about coming together, no matter our experiences or feelings in this season, and turning our eyes to Jesus. He's like that famous star that the wise men followed, far enough above our world and our lives that he can be seen from wherever we are, showing us the direction that we should go, beckoning us towards himself. And yet, the paradox of Christmas is that Jesus, who is so far above us, comes near to us. James 4, verse 8 in the Bible says, "Come near to God, and he will come near to you." Let's spend a moment in prayer together. Lord Jesus, thank you that you have brought us here today. It's Christmas, and that brings with it so many different thoughts and feelings for us all. Some of us are here out of habit. Some of us are curious. Some of us are anxious. Some of us are expectant. Some of us are tired. Some of us are glad. Some of us are reluctant. Wherever we are, will you come near to us? As we reflect on you this morning and revisit the familiar story of your birth, will you make it new to us? Make it real? Lift our hearts. Give us hope. Fill us with joy. Amen. Before we move forward with our service, let me just pause for some housekeeping for those of you who aren't familiar with our space. So firstly, my name is Hannah, and I'm your service leader for today. Later on, we'll meet Reuben, who's one of our pastors, and he's going to finish off our Christmas Carol series by looking at the carol Joy to the World. If you need the bathrooms at all this morning, you can find them down the hallway near the front doors. We have a creche running for children 2 and under in the kids zone, which you can find by turning left at the back of the auditorium. For older children, we'll have a kids talk a bit later on up the front here. And we also have some activity sheets and pencils, which you're welcome to grab from the back of the auditorium on the table. If you have any other questions, please feel welcome to ask any of the friendly people around you, or you can also seek out our welcomers who are in the black Riverbank t-shirt. Now we're going to move into a time of Bible reading and song, working our way through the Christmas story as it's told in the Bible. So I'll invite Tommy up now, and he's going to read our first section.
The passage I'll be reading from this morning is Matthew chapter 1, verses 18 through to 23. This is how the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son. You are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet. "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." And now, if you all would like to stand, we will sing, "Come, All Ye Faithful."
Reading now from Aria.
This morning I'll be reading Luke chapter 2, verses 1 to 12. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria, and everybody went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and the line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in cloths and placed him in a manger because there was no guest rooms available for them. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring you good news that will cause great joy for all the people. Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You'll find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Can we now stand and sing Angels We Have Heard on High?
I'll be reading from Luke chapter 2, verses 13 to 20. Suddenly a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels have left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in a manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all these things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told. Please stand and sing, Hark the Herald Angels Sing.
Scotty Smith for the Gospel Coalition. Please join me as we worship Jesus through this prayer. Dear Lord Jesus, a most glorious and praise-filled happy birthday to you. Angels harked, shepherds ran, and Mary pondered the very good news which fills our hearts this day. Though you've lived forever in rich, joyful, pleasure-filled relationship with the Father and the Spirit, today we celebrate your coming to us and for us. There is no one like you, Jesus, no other God beside you, no other Saviour that can truly save, no one as lovely or loving as you, no one more worthy of our heart's affection and adoration. We praise you for being born in Bethlehem, the house of bread. We were a starving people, binge eating at many empty buffets. But you came as the bread of life, bringing the feast of the gospel to our souls. You satisfy our deepest hunger with good things, grace things. You are the King of kings and Lord of lords, presently reigning over everything and working in all things for your glory and our good. You are the ruler of the kings of the earth, setting leaders up and sitting them down at your sovereign discretion. No other kingdom but yours is everlasting. There will never be an end to the increase of your government and peace. Hallelujah. How we long for that magnificent day when every knee will bow and every tongue will confess that you are Lord to the glory of God the Father. How we earnestly crave that merciful day when you return to finish making all things new, including us. Hasten that day, oh, that it would be in our lifetime. Until then, we will seek to live and love to your glory. Happy birthday indeed, Lord Jesus. You are so easy to love and so worthy to be adored. Amen. It's time for our kids' talk now. So children, come on up to the front and find a spot on the floor where you can see Mrs. Ronnie. She's got something to share with you.
Well, hello, boys and girls, and Merry Christmas to you. It's good to see you here this morning. Who's excited today? Yeah, me too. It's a great day, isn't it? You love Christmas, yeah. I brought with me a painting, one that I did years ago, and doesn't really have a right way up. It's because it's kind of a mixed, jumbly kind of a painting here. Look at that. Can you see over there? You want to scooch in a little bit so that you can, if everybody comes this way a little bit, then those people over there can see, because I'm not sure you can see back there. Can you see now? Yeah? So this painting that I made a long time ago was just of things that I could see at Christmas. And what can you see in my painting? What can you see? You can see Santa.
Ho, 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 Merry Christmas.
What can you see? You can see balloons, yes. We have lots of decorations at Christmas. We also have lots of parties at Christmas time. Sometimes you have parties at school, sometimes at work we have end of year parties. So lots of celebrating going on. What can you see? A Christmas tree, yes, on its side there. What can you see? Presents. Wooly dooly, lots of presents. That's cool. What can you see? A snowman? Oh, yes. What kind of a card is that? It's Christmas cards. Did you get any Christmas cards?
No.
No. That used to be a thing. I told you the painting was old. Yeah, some of you did. Good, 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 good. Is there anything on there we haven't mentioned yet? What can you see? What can you see? Yeah, yeah. What's this thing?
A chicken.
A chicken? Yeah, it could be a turkey too. Probably a turkey because it's so big and round. Some people love to eat turkey at Christmas. Other people like to have other special Christmas dinners. Food is a big thing that we like to enjoy at Christmas, isn't it? What are these?
Pasta.
Yes. Fizzy drinks. Yum. Fizzy drinks. Oh, now, this is, what on earth is that? What is it? You recognise it. I'm impressed. This is the way TVs looked many, many years ago. They've changed a lot since then. And this bit here is where you put the video in so that you could watch a movie. Who likes watching movies? Yeah, that's something my family would do at Christmas time. We would watch movies. Yeah. Yeah. So that's my Christmas picture. But I wonder what Christmas is all about. I wonder if we took the Christmas cards that not many of you got anyway, and we said, nah, no Christmas cards, let's take them away. Would it still be Christmas? It's still Christmas, isn't it? Even if we didn't have any cards. Yeah. what about if we took away all the special Christmas food and drinks, all of the parties, or all of the dinner parties? Would it still be Christmas?
Yeah.
Of course it would be, wouldn't it? Yeah. What about no Santa and no presents? Will it still be Christmas? Yeah. What about no balloons? Yeah. No TV? What about no Christmas tree? Oh, what's that? Oh, look. That's what Christmas is all about, isn't it? Yeah, baby Jesus, that's right. Did you know that none of you could see baby Jesus in my picture before? That's a bit of an illustration of what it can be like sometimes at Christmas time.
Baby Jesus was born for Christmas.
You eat sausages, that's great. We can get so distracted by all those fun things at Christmas that sometimes we can forget that Christmas is really about baby Jesus. Jesus came down from heaven to become a baby in a lowly little manger so that he could one day come and die on the cross for our sins. As John 3:16 says, God so loved the world that he gave his only son. That's Jesus, right? He gave his only son that whoever believes in him may have eternal life. So let's remember that Christmas is all about
Jesus.
That's right, boys and girls. We've got a Christmas song. I don't know this song, so I'm going to be learning it with you. How about we get on our feet and we give it our best?
The Christmas tree reminds you of the one who trusts the Lord, who walks the path of godliness and loves to hear God's word. Pray that as you grow up, that's just how you will be, standing tall for Jesus like the Christmas tree. And your love shall have
Let your faith grow.
children, you can head back to your seats. Don't forget you can grab an activity sheet from the back if you like. It's time for another reading from the Bible now. This time we're going to read from a different part. It's from a book of songs called the Psalms. And this is number 98. So Psalm 98. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the nations. He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our God. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy. Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the people with equity.
Thanks, Hannah, and good morning, everyone. Merry Christmas. We're so glad you're here. My name's Reuben. I'm one of the pastors here at Riverbank. And today we're going to think about one of the most famous Christmas carols of all time, Joy to the World. Before we get into it, though, let's pray together. Let's pray for a minute. Lord God, as we open the Bible now and think about what you're saying to us, we pray that you will help us to understand. We pray that you will help us to know Jesus more and to love him more. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, when I was a child, I fell in love with maybe one of the greatest kids' books of all time, The Lion, the Witch and the Wardrobe by C.S. Lewis. And it tells the story of four children who stumble through a wardrobe into this magical world called Narnia. And they're mesmerized by the beautiful snow and the trees and the magical creatures that they meet until they start to realize, hang on a minute, something is wrong with Narnia. They learn that there's this wicked witch of the north and she has put a curse on Narnia so that it is always winter. The land is poisoned by this dark evil, and as a result, nothing ever reaches its true potential. Spring never comes. It's always winter, and for all the creatures who live in Narnia, they're in a permanent state of gloom. Now, one of the amazing things about C.S. Lewis is that he's not just telling a fantastical story, he's also trying to help us understand our own world. He's inviting us to consider the possibility that maybe our world is more like cursed Narnia than we realize. I doubt there's a single person in this room over the age of 10 who hasn't at least once asked the question, what's wrong with our world? I mean, have you paused to consider what Christmas today will be like in Gaza? Or in Ukraine? Why are people so unkind to each other when we all want to live in a world of love? And why do our happiest moments with family, with fun, with achievements, why do they always seem to fade so quickly? And I mean, it's 2023. Why hasn't all our progress with science and with medicine and with education and with technology, why has it never really managed to make things that much better? Why are people more depressed and more anxious and more lonely than ever before? Could it be that we live in a cursed world where it's always winter? Now, I know this is a heavy start to Christmas Day, but some of us are a bit tired of pretending. Some of us are craving a bit of raw honesty. I saw some of that last week. A few days ago, an Australian journalist called Paul Daly wrote this about Christmas. This was in The Guardian. Christmas, most of us are brought up to believe, is all about joy. But then, brutally honest, Paul Daly says this: joy feels as elusive as a Tassie tiger right now. It is a unicorn, a needle in a haystack. I know I'm not at all alone when I say that this year, finding joy feels almost impossible. That's how Paul's feeling. What hope is there for Paul and for the rest of us who have maybe just a niggling fear that he could be right? Well, The Lion, the Witch, and the Wardrobe is a story of how Narnia's curse came to be lifted. And the ice slowly begins to melt and the flowers begin to bloom and the trees begin to turn green. And it's a made-up story, but through it, C.S. Lewis is leading us into another story, and it's a true story. It's the true story of how God came to liberate our cursed, broken world. And this is what the Christmas carol, Joy to the World, is all about. The guy who wrote this carol is called Isaac Watts, and he based it on the Bible passage that we just read before, Psalm 98. Today, I want to invite you to look at Psalm 98 with me for a few minutes and discover how God plans to bring joy to our world. Paul Daly said that finding joy feels almost impossible at the moment. Well, Psalm 98 says, "Let me tell you something so astoundingly good that you will burst with joy when you hear it." So if you haven't already, I'd love you to open a Bible to Psalm 98, maybe on your phone, maybe you've got a paper Bible with you. You'll notice that this psalm has 9 verses divided into 3 sections. And we're going to work backwards today through this psalm. We're going to start with section 3. In section 3, verses 7 to 9, we get to look into the future through a telescope and catch a glimpse of the world that we are longing for. This is our first point, our future hope. Our future hope. See what verses 7 and 8 say? "Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it. Let the rivers clap their hands. Let the mountains sing together for joy." It's this beautiful poetic picture of the whole world rejoicing. Not just the people, but the sea, the rivers, the mountains all singing and clapping and celebrating. Why? Because the world has been liberated from cancer, from pollution, from rot. The curse has been lifted. How is that possible? It's there in verse 9. See what it says: "Let them sing before the Lord, for he comes to judge the earth. He will judge the world in righteousness and the peoples with equity." Creation is rejoicing because someone has come to judge the earth. And we say, hang on a minute, judgment, is that a good thing? That sounds pretty negative. But the word for judge here really means to restore everything to how it should be. It's talking about everything in the world being made right. Have you ever pulled on a piece of wool or string or maybe an extension cord and suddenly found things getting a bit tangled? Okay, I'm famously bad at this, and I always think, it's fine, I know how to fix it. I see this loose end here, I'm just going to poke it back through there, and voila, it's way worse. Now I've got 10 knots And then I try again, and before I know it, I've got this tangled, impossible bird's nest of a thing. Sometimes our world feels a bit like that, doesn't it? Like, who can unravel it? Who can untie all the knots? Who could free every slave? Who could feed every belly? Adopt every orphan? Cure every disease? Protect every endangered species? Solve every climate problem? The list of war crimes and rapes and bribes and lies is so long that no one can keep count, and we lose hope of justice ever being done. Our world has become this impossibly tangled up ball of string. Psalm 98 says, one day someone's coming to untangle it. Listen to how this is described at the end of the Bible in Revelation 21. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. There will be no more death, or mourning, or crying, or pain. For the old order of things has passed away. He who was seated on the throne said, I am making everything new. Doesn't that sound utterly wonderful? Isn't that really what we're longing for? And friends, that's what God has promised to do. It's what's going to happen when King Jesus comes back and sets up his perfect kingdom on earth. In his book, Eternity Changes Everything, Stephen Whitmer writes this. God invites us to imagine what he has in store, to imagine the beauty of this world multiplied 1,000 times and all its badness removed. Think of the keenest pleasures you've experienced in this world. Now imagine them heightened and purified and prolonged forever. Colors will be more vivid, jokes funnier, and the taste of food richer. Somehow a steak will be more a steak. A flower will be more a flower. A friend will be more a friend. And then Whitmer goes on to say this. In this life, we're experiencing only a fraction of true life. We're like the little kid who bangs away on 3 piano keys and thinks he's playing the piano. The new creation is God's invitation to enjoy the rest of the keyboard. This new world is what Isaac Watts was dreaming of when he wrote Joy to the World. I'm going to read these lyrics now. And as I do, I want you to let your mind imagine what this glorious future could be like. Joy to the world, the Lord has come. Let earth receive her king. Let every heart prepare him room. And heaven and nature sing. Joy to the earth, the Savior reigns. Let all their songs employ. While fields and floods, rocks, hills and plains repeat the sounding joy, repeat the sounding joy, repeat, repeat the sounding joy. No more let sin and sorrow grow, nor thorns infest the ground. He comes to make his blessings flow, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found, far as the curse is found. And then the final verse, he rules the world with truth and grace, and makes the nations prove the glories of his righteousness and wonders of his love, and wonders of his love, wonders, wonders of his love. If you are longing for a better world, for a king who rules that world with truth and grace and love and faithfulness and righteousness, then my friend, know this. You are not longing for a Narnian fantasy that will never actually come true. You are longing for exactly what God wants to give you. This is our future hope. It's our first point this morning. But maybe you say, well, that sounds lovely, and I would like to believe it's true, but honestly, it does sound like wishful thinking. How do you know this is actually going to happen? How could it happen? And I'm glad you asked. That's exactly the question we should ask. If you want to understand Christianity, if you want to understand Christmas, you must understand this. The future is certain because of the past. Or to put it another way, we know that that king will come because he has already come once before. Now come back with me to section one of our psalm as we look at our past salvation. We've looked at our future hope. Now we want to look at our past salvation. We're going from looking forward to the future to looking back. See what Psalm 98 verse 1 says. Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him. And then verses 2 and 3 go on and say, it's such a great salvation that the whole world has heard about it. What's he talking about? Well, our loving God, he's done many amazing things through history. But there is one great victory. There's one marvelous act of salvation that shines the brightest. It's like the biggest golden star at the top of the tree. Long ago, at the very first Christmas, on a quiet night, God came down from heaven. He became a human. He was born as a baby, and he was given the name Jesus. And you might be asking, well, why is that such a big deal? To understand why Christmas is so much more than just a pretty little nativity scene, we have to go back to that question we asked at the start. Do you remember the question we were asking? What's wrong with our world? And here's the Bible's answer. Are you ready? The big problem with our world is that we're cut off from God. To be more precise, we have cut ourselves off from God. Cut a ship from its anchor and it will drift towards the rocks. Cut the umbilical cord of a baby in the womb and it will die. And cut the world off from God, the source of all life and all love, and it will start to decay and die. And friends, this is why it's always winter. This is why evil and suffering poisons everything. This is why nothing quite seems to bloom or satisfy like we know it should. It's because each of us have rejected God. We've cut ourselves off from the giver of life. And as a result, we've come under his right and his fair judgment. The day's coming where every one of us are going to have to stand before his throne, and we're going to have to give an account for whether or not we loved and we worshipped and we obeyed that great God as we should have, and whether we loved others with complete kindness and care. When I was a teenager, I was often overwhelmed by my thoughts, and so I would try to express myself by writing songs. Just the other day, I looked through some of these lyrics, and I was struck by this recurring theme in a lot of what I'd written. Again and again, to put it in Bible language, I was writing about my sin. I kept writing about how sin seemed to have this unbreakable, deathly grip on me. So, for example, here are some lovely depressing lyrics that teenage Reuben wrote. Deep in my soul, the monster creeps. Out through my pores, its venom seeps. Traveling over the sea, trying to escape a part of me. A part of me that never seems to leave. it's dark. But have you ever felt that kind of despair for yourself? The despair of realizing that the main problem with the world is not out there, but in here? The heartbreaking realization that you have completely stuffed it up with God. That you're not actually mostly a good person. And that trying to save yourself is futile. Now, if that was the end of the story, then all of our songs, I think, would be about as depressing as the songs that teenage Reuben wrote. But what does verse 1 of Psalm 98 say? It says, "Sing to the Lord a new song, for he has done marvelous things." Who has done the marvelous things? He has. With his mighty hand, without our help, and without our deserving it, God came to live in the world that hated him. And he came with humility, and he came with love, he came with truth, he came with power. And wherever he went, he began to set things right. You read through the story of Jesus' life, and it's amazing how he's reversing the curse. The sick were healed, the blind could see, demons were removed, the hungry were fed, the dead were raised, and then underpinning all of those marvelous deeds, he goes around preaching this good news: I'm the king you've been waiting for, and I'm bringing my kingdom. Man, those would have been exciting days. And then to everyone's shock and dismay, instead of receiving a gold crown and ascending to his throne in Jerusalem, he receives a crown of twisted thorns and he ascends a cross outside of the city. And in that moment, it really seemed that evil and death had won. And it would be winter forever. But then as the dead body of Jesus lay in the grave, the first sign of spring appeared. His heart suddenly started beating again. And then his blood began to flow, warming up his stone-cold body. And then the God-man got up from his deathbed and he walked into the dawning sunlight, never to die again. Joy to the world. Joy to the guilty. Jesus has taken the judgment that we deserve and we're free. Joy to those with deep regrets. Jesus remembers your sin no more. Joy to those who've wandered so far that they can't help but think God would never want them back. Jesus beckons to you with open arms. Joy to those in the grip of addiction. Jesus' power lives in you. Joy to those who feel alone. Jesus is always with you. Joy to those struggling with broken, messy relationships. Jesus can fill your heart with love. Joy to those who are depressed. Jesus has entered the darkness and he's overcome it. Joy to those who are critically ill. Jesus has risen and death is not the end. Joy to those who live with constant pain. Jesus has broken the curse and is going to make all things new. Joy to those who have been abused. Jesus will defend you. Joy to those who grieve over all the evil and injustice of our world. Jesus is coming again to set everything right. You know, Joy to the World is a funny carol to sing at Christmas time. One of the most famous carols of all. And it doesn't even talk about the birth of Jesus. And yet I think Joy to the World understands exactly what Christmas is all about. It looks forward to the coming of the King with absolute confidence and joy because it knows he has already come once before and he's already won the victory over sin and death and Satan, and he's already started his work of renewal, of joy giving in our hearts. Some people say that Christianity is wishful thinking. Like a boy who really wants a new bike for Christmas, but he's probably really not going to get one. But friends, the hope of Christianity is more like the boy who knows he's getting a new bike for Christmas, because he can see there's this enormous wrapped object which looks exactly like a bike, and it's under the tree, and it's got a tag on it with his name on it. That's Christian hope. If you put your trust in Jesus, then your future has been purchased and it has been wrapped and prepared for you just as surely as that bike has been purchased and wrapped and placed under the tree ready for Christmas morning. So, we're about to land this thing. We've looked at our future hope. We've looked at our past salvation. What about right now? As we finish, let's think briefly about our present joy. Our present joy. You see, section 2 of Psalm 98, in verses 4 to 6. What should our response be if we know that our world is terribly damaged by sin, but also know that Jesus is returning soon to fix everything? The answer's there in verses 4 to 6. Let's read them together. Shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music. Make music to the Lord with the harp and the sound of singing, with trumpets and the blast of the ram's horn. Shout for joy before the Lord, the King. Here's my paraphrase. God wants our joy to be ear-splittingly loud. He wants our future hope to manifest itself in such an eruption of praise and song and celebration that the neighbors open their windows to eavesdrop and wonder what those Christians are so happy about. Yes, we are still waiting for the King to return, but we don't wait to celebrate. Joy to the World is a song about the future, but when do we sing it? We sing it right now. And when we sing, we are rehearsing for that great day when it's not just going to be a few hundred voices in a hall in Riverside. It's going to be the millions of saints, everyone ever saved through all history, joining with the angelic hosts of heaven and all of nature, every rock, tree, field, mountain, all exploding with joy because the Lord has come. I'm going to invite the band up now because we are about to sing and we are about to raise the roof and declare to the world that there is joy. Joy for all strugglers and sinners and sufferers who come to Jesus. And if you're not a follower of Jesus and you're here this morning, I want to seriously urge you to consider what's wrong with our world. And I know you might be scared to face that question head on because you're worried that you might just end up melting into a puddle of despair like Paul Daly. But not if you turn to Jesus. The curse breaker, the sin forgiver, the joy giver. This Christmas, will you make room in your heart for him? And if you're here and you've already done this, but you're weary, you're drifting, you're downhearted, well, dear child of the King, please know this. He's coming back soon. coming to make his blessings flow as far as the curse is found, coming to fill us with unquenchable joy. Won't that be good? Let's stand right now. Let's stand and let's make a tidal wave of praise to the coming King. Let's sing.
Encouraged by your time with us today. If you have time to stay for a tea and or a coffee and a chat afterwards, please do. We'd love that. We ask that anyone who regularly attends Riverbank, whose last names start with W, A, B or C, if you can, to help serve and clean up in the kitchen. Also, I just want to mention that we have a special collection of money today for World Transform. This is a mission that our church loves to support, where the good news of Jesus is shared alongside practical aid and development work in needy communities internationally. If you feel that you can share some of what you have with this cause, you can do so either by putting cash in the box at the back of the auditorium, or you can do so electronically using the details that are also at the cash box. As we finish, I'm going to read a very famous verse from the Bible. It's already been echoed throughout our service today. John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his one and only Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. Let's sing one more song together. Have a joyful Christmas.